Let's go before the questions to the last presentation. In that case is Mr. Alok Katiyar, I think I pronounced properly. He is general manager of the Indian Railway and has been working in also in Metro Lines for many years, and now is working as responsible for the National High Speed Rail Corporation, trying to develop the new high speed project in India. Okay, Mr. Katiyar, you have the floor.
Ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning to all of you who are here. Among all things which I am learning about the high speed is that it teaches us value of the time also. And from the time which I have been given for my presentation, I would like to take out 1 or 2 minutes to talk about the Congress itself. It's been a great honor and my privilege to be invited here on this Congress, on the International Congress on the High Speed. And I must admit that this is one of the best conference or Congress I have attended so far in last many years. Basically, I say so because of the topics which have been covered in this Congress. They cover a very, very wide spectrum of the knowledge base, right from the economic impact analysis to the technical subjects. And it is not only the subjects, but I found that the speakers are one of the most knowledgeable speakers, research scholars, professors. Most of the conferences which I have been seen are kind of promotion for certain kind of either technologies or other items, but this was the one which I found is really, really very useful for the persons who are either planning or building or running a high-speed technology. It covers the topics for almost in all those areas. Saying so, I must say my honest and sincere thanks to the Honorable Chairman of the Congress and his team for organizing this almost a very perfect event, where I think all of us have been taken care of very, very nicely and very, very warmly. Before my start presentation, I must also mention a special thing about my coming here. My coming here was decided at the last moment, and I must thank Ms. Begonia. In just, I think, in less than 5 days, everything for me was arranged, including my visa, and when I was thinking that I'll not be able to go, I got the call that everything is ready, you please pack the bags and come. In fact, I forgot half of my things at my home. But the speed with which it was executed and worked, I think now I can understand how Spain is making high speed with such a high speed. Thank you so much for inviting me here and taking care of all of us. So I'll be talking about now presentation. That was a little bit about the Congress. India is making the first high speed from Mumbai to Ahmedabad. It has been dream of India as a nation to have a high speed. The first corridor of high speed, about 508 kilometers, is sanctioned. And we have started working on it. I got a small movie. We'll start with the movie and then we'll go to the presentation. Play the movie, please.
The Indian High-Speed Railway connects the financial hub of Mumbai to Ahmedabad and Sabarmati, a major commercial and industrial center, and will reduce the journey time between them to just 2 hours. Mumbai station is planned as an underground station in the central business district. This will be the first railway line in India that will pass through an undersea tunnel between Mumbai and Thane. High-speed railway terminal station built in Sabarmati. The new Sabarmati station is expected to boost development and economic activity in its vicinity. Sabarmati Depot and Workshop is set up in the northern part of the station, and it will be the base for high-speed railway operation. The Indian High-Speed Railway has been a project on India's wish list for over 30 years. That wish is about to come true in the near future. India and Japan will collaborate and work together to realize this dream.
So that was a small movie about the visualization of our high speed, and the work on this line has already started. We'll move on to the presentation. So thanking once again for extending us invitation for this Congress. As it was shown into the movie, India has started building its dream of last more than 30 years, the first high speed rail corridor between Mumbai and Ahmedabad, which is roughly 508 kilometers. So this is first high-speed rail corridor, and it is being executed by a government special purpose vehicle named as National High-Speed Rail Corporation Limited. This has been created specifically for the implementation of the high-speed projects whichever will now be coming into the India. And the first project being implemented by this, which is sanctioned already, is the Mumbai-Ahmedabad high-speed railway. In the presentation, I would be very briefly covering these topics. First is our high-speed project, Indian high-speed project. Second, what are the key features for this project as we think, the objectives for this project, a little bit about our organization, that is NHSRCL, National High-Speed Rail Corporation Limited. And then that focus is on the safety, reliability, availability, and the passenger comfort. As we all must be aware that the India is moving very strongly ahead for Make in India concept. When we are trying to take in the new technologies, we also make a focus to adopt the procedure of making them in India. This is the topographical survey, locational, I can say, the view, which shows all the 12 stations, which is rather in the western part of the India, starting from Mumbai to Ahmedabad and then covering rest 12 of the stations. The government of India has sanctioned this Mumbai-Ahmedabad high-speed rail in December 2015. So almost now 1.5 years. It is at approximately cost of 1080 billion rupees. Or roughly $16.61 billion. It is the project is being executed with the support of the Japanese loan, which is almost 81% of the total project cost. It has a repayment period of 50 years with a grace period of 15 years. And it is one of the lowest interest rates at 0.1%. It is a fully elevated corridor with a standard gauge track. The project will have 12 stations between Mumbai and Sabarmati. That is, Sabarmati is, we call Ahmedabad, next to the Ahmedabad station. The Mumbai station, Thane station, Virar, so one at Boisar, one Vapi, Bilimora, Surat, Bharuch, Vadodara, Anand, Ahmedabad, and Sabarmati. Out of this, the already established and large areas are Mumbai, and then when we come Surat, then Vadodara, and then Ahmedabad, and it is expected that the introduction of high speed will bring rest of the areas also to the same level of urbanization.
The maximum design speed for the project has been kept as 350 kilometers per hour, and the operating speed would be 320 kilometers per hour. The journey time for the fastest train from Sabarmati to Mumbai is expected to be around 2 hours and 7 minutes, while as the, for the train which will be stopping at all the 12 stations is roughly 2 hours, 58 minutes. The key features for the project are that we have an undersea tunnel that will be almost of 21 kilometers, that is just at the start of the Mumbai, under Thane Creek. Then we have 27 numbers of very, very special kind of bridges. Some of the bridges are coming either on the existing lines or are very, very typical in nature. The high-speed track will be adjacent to the existing lines also. It will be near Vadodara station, almost 8 kilometers, then Ahmedabad and Sabarmati depot, that is around 18 kilometers. And it has been kept to keep the high-speed stations into the center of the city, so as to provide convenience for the people to travel to the stations. The Mumbai area station is planned to be the underground. 2x25 kV heavy compound catenary system, overhead system is planned, and a digital signal automatic train control system, which is being used in Shinkansen, similar to Shinkansen, is proposed to be used on this project. We'll have two major maintenance depots. One is at Sabarmati and another one at Thane. The key objectives is that it is to be developed on a proven Japanese high-speed rail technology, Shinkansen. Basically, the project is being executed with a very high percentage of loan, and that therefore it was decided that we shall be using a proven Japanese technology, which is already proven. The human resource development, which is very, very important for the countries which are coming now into the high speed, is being taken care of especially with the team of experts. And the first one to come up actually is the training institute on which the work has started. The work has already started before everything else on the training institute to train the people for not only for the operation but maintenance and other construction issues also. There is a transfer of technology for construction and manufacturing. Make in India of high-speed railway systems, including manufacturing of rolling stock, other equipments and machinery, is to be promoted in a phased manner. Not immediately, but in a phased manner. That is one of the primary objectives for the high-speed railway. The target date of commissioning as such was 2023, but in all probability will be preponed to the 2022. Now about National High Speed Rail Corporation Limited. It is a joint ownership company of Government of India and participating state governments. For this project, the two state governments which are participating are Gujarat and Maharashtra. The company was incorporated in 2016, and it has been mandated to implement high speed train projects in India. And the first one is Mumbai-Ahmedabad High Speed Rail Corridor. Its head office is in Delhi, and major project offices will be in Ahmedabad, Vadodara, Mumbai, and maybe few small offices at Surat and Vapi also. The maintenance organization is already under discussion and with the planning, is under discussion and planning with the team of experts. The organizational structure is simple, as like most of the companies, we have one managing director. There are three directors, and they are supported by a team of officials from all kinds of discipline, that is civil, track, electrical, engineering, health, safety, human resources, etc. The project offices, as I mentioned, are in Mumbai, Ahmedabad, and Vadodara. That is a small picture of our new office, which has come up now near Delhi, Dwarka. Now, these are the items which I think most of the areas are already considered or known to the most of the persons, that will be following the technology which are already there at a standard gauge, but with a little difference, because the technologies have to be adopted to the Indian conditions and climate. We plan to use a standard gauge, but with bigger size coaches. SOD, but is kept much smaller, because when the SOD is kept smaller, the construction cost of the viaduct or the tunnels is much lesser than a bigger SOD. Second is the electrical efficiency. In the planning is also to have the maximum seating capacity while retaining the standard gauge. And there's a small comparison here, which shows that among available all kinds of trains, we plan to have almost double the passengers into the same train, giving them the same level of comfort by having a little wider body of the coach. Energy efficiency, because more number of passengers are planned to be carried by the same coach, it automatically will increase into the lot of energy saving, and efficiency will also be better for the system. A 400 meters train set is planned or proposed to hold about 1,323 passengers in compared to last data which I gathered, or was roughly 516 or 20 of the TGV duplex. Safety is one of the most important factor for the project, and we are working on the system which has a provenness of more than 50 years with absolutely no fatality record of last 50 years. The parameters of safety, in fact, encompass or passes, they are much level higher than the Silford systems, as my friends here would be knowing. The levels of the safety are much higher than the defined in the Senlac standards, EN50126, 28289. There is a very highly careful consideration for adoption of these equipment or systems to India, because India has a very, very harsh environment. The climatic conditions of India has to suit these equipments, or rather these equipments also have to suit the climatic conditions of India. So there is a lot of work going on to adopt the equipments, whatever is brought into use, so they can be sustained into the Indian climatic as well as social conditions. Then impact of every change from the proven technology is being evaluated and assessed, not only by in-house but also by external team of experts. The safety critical parameters of all systems, it may be signaling, rolling stock, track, they are continuously monitored, and not only monitored, in our case, will be reacted upon also, including automatic stoppages of train if there is anything which we find is not safe enough for the train to travel. So another part is the disaster management, which includes monitoring of the earthquakes and automatic stoppages of the trains in case of the earthquakes. There's a continuous monitoring of rail temperature, wind pressure, rain, cyclone, and other items. Any kind of disaster will lead to the monitoring, and that monitoring will result either into the automatic or in manual reaction of control of the trains. The reliability, second, is equally important. After the safety, the systems has to be reliable. The technology which has been picked up has a proven record of average 30 seconds delay per train yearly. The system and equipments are further being strengthened, as I said, for harsh Indian climatic and social conditions. There are simultaneously simulations are going on for these equipments, that how they are going to perform in these conditions and what will be the results, and Institute of RTRI is helping us on this. There is a centralized comprehensive train control system, I think, which is more or less common, and I'm coming to the end. Now this is one of the most important part, just before finishing, that for every large infrastructure project, one of the biggest focus is upon the make in India. So whenever we are taking the technology, we try our level best that some part or full part or at least whatever part, it has to be decided before the project starts, should be made in India. And for this, there is a Department of Industrial Policy and promotion, which is working very, very seriously along with NHSRCL. There are 5 subgroups which are working regularly in this area to make the target of Make in India. So this is the last one. This is a small movie. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you.
We understand now. Well, thank you very much for all the three presentations. I think we are really out of time, but probably there are probably many, many questions from the audience. I allowed to have one or two because we are a bit late, but it's coffee time now. Perhaps we can stall some minutes from this pause time. So there have been three very clearly presentations from different stages of projects. One of them is China case from a very, very mature network with the biggest in the world, everybody knows, and with a lot of experiences, which is really impressive, so probably leading all the world in the way to go forward. The second one is something which is about to start, Mecca Medina, and the third one is a project ahead, probably in the coming 5 years. So it's something that is in different stages of the process. And perhaps one of the things that strikes me most is the two biggest countries in terms of population in the world, China and India, all of them are engaged in high-speed rail developments, which is probably something that never happened before in any other infrastructure developments. And this is something, I think, unique, and they are probably leading more than other Western countries development in this matter, which is really the future for the transportation system and changing also shares in the different modes of transport from long distance trips. Let's go for the two or three questions. Let me introduce myself. I'm Andrés Monzón, professor of the University of Madrid. I would say the brother school of this, or probably the father school, or even the grandfather school, probably, because. But anyway, it's a similar civil engineering school, and I'm teaching in the transportation planning courses, and also currently director of the Transportation Research Center of this university. Anyway, I would like you, anyone interested in having posing a question to any of the three speakers, introduce himself, and name and affiliation, and please be short in the questions. Any question in the, no question. The organization, well, Jaime, very short question, Jaime, and then close. There is any micro?
I'm Jaime Tamariz from the University of Castilla-La Mancha, and I would like to know, are you using the same frequencies and the transmission media in the urban system in the level one, and the frequencies for the SMR are the same as we are using in the law, or you have different bandwidths for the SMR transmission?
You ask to the chat? Feija, okay.
I think your question is maybe about the difference between the GSMR system in China and the European one. What's that? Firstly, I'm not a specialist in that field, but I just know some little details about that. The GSMR is mainly a different. The European ones too, yeah. As the CDCS3 is for the high-speed railways in China, built at present, adopt the GSMR. And we have a radio center that connect. It's a little different. Maybe I don't know exactly the frequency in European ones, what the exact number, but we have demands for that. So. We ask for the demise and incorporate help us to make that, and maybe for the exact number I can search for that, and we can talk later about that. Okay, thank you for your question.
Okay, thank you. I think we have no more time. According to the clear signs from the organizers. So thanks to all the three presentations, very lively, very nice. And I think we have coffee break and something outside. Thank you very much.